الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. Before I start, inshallah ta'ala, if all the brothers can come together and close and fill the little gaps, بإذن الله الكريم. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one day he saw his companions and they were all over the, they were all under the shades. And then he said, Mali arakum izin. Why is it that I see you all trying to go under the shade and not coming close? And from that day onwards, the narrator, he said that the Sahabas, they came so close to one another that if a cloth was to be thrown, it would encompass all of them. They became very close to one another. So don't leave no gaps, inshaAllah ta'ala. InshaAllah ta'ala, we're going to be studying this book, Hilyatu Talib al-Ilm, by Sheikh Bakr ibn Abdullah Abu Zayd. The book is written by Al-Allama, Fadilatu Shaykh Bakr ibn Abdullah Abu Zayd. So today we're going to take the biography of the author, inshaAllah ta'ala, and we're also going to take the muqaddimah of the book. Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd, his name is Bakr ibn Abdullah Abu Zayd rahimahullah. The Shaykh was born when the year was 1364 Hijriya. That's when the Shaykh was born, rahimahullah. And he's from a city or a place called Shaqra, which is in Najd. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he was born nash'atan karima. He was raised in a very respectful and honorable way, in a household which knowledge and khair was being spread. And as you all know, the child's upbringing has an effect on his, when he grows up later in age. If your household is a place where knowledge and khair is being spread, then it will affect you when you grow older. ولذلك, that's why the scholars, they say, al-ilmu fi al-sigari. Knowledge when you're very little, and what you learn when you're young, is kanaqsha al-hajar. It's like carving into a rock. Trying to memorize and learn when you're young is like that. It's just like you're carving into a rock. And al-ilmu fil kibar. But when you want to study and learn in an old age, kal-kitabatu al-ma, is like writing on water. The person just forgets everything a lot. You see, and the Shaykh rahimahullah, his family, they were people of knowledge and khair. And so that allowed him to have the correct upbringing. At a very young age, the Shaykh, he went to nursery and reception and he learned how to write and how to read. Then he went to ibtida'iyah, which is primary. And he done all of this in Riyadh. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he carried on his studying and he didn't have no inqita'. His studying did not have any disconnection, meaning he was continuous on learning. Sometimes what happens is a person finishes secondary school and for a long time they just sit around and then they go back to studying again. The Shaykh wasn't like that. Studying was continuous, alayhi rahmatullah. At that time, Riyadh University, they opened a ma'ad called Al-Ma'had Al-Alami, Al-Ma'had Al-Ali Lil-Ilm, which it just opened. And it was then, at that particular time, it was called Jama'atul Riyadh. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he went directly to Kulliyatul Shaykh. But when he was teaching the Shaykh, he was mutaqa'id. He wasn't then a judge at that particular moment. He also took knowledge from, and this Shaykh, Shaykh Salah ibn Abdullah ibn Mutriq, hafidha Maqamatul Hariri. Kitab Maqamatul Hariri, Salah ibn Abdullah ibn Mutriq memorized it from the top of his head. Maqamat al-Hariri is min as'abi kutub al-adab. It's one of the hardest book when it comes to the Arabic literature. In terms of its wordings, in terms of its structure, it's a very hard book, let alone to memorize it, to even understand it. After it's been explained to you so many times, it's hard to understand it. I struggle to understand my own notes that I write on it. It's a very hard, complicated book. The Shaykh Salih ibn Abdullah ibn Mutlaq, he memorized it. And inshallah ta'ala, when we speak about Shaykh Bakr a bit more later, you will realize that type of language usage, it was something that he was familiar with. Also, he took knowledge from and he stayed with him for a very long time, Shaykh al-Allama Badi'u al-Zaman. And he was a mufti, Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah ibn Baz, rahimahullah. He stayed with Shaykh ibn Baz for a very long time. And he studied from him, and he read a lot of books on him. He read on him the Kitab al-Muntaqa. The Kitab al-Muntaqa, which is the sharah, which is the kitab which Al-Imam al-Shawkani, Nail al-Awtar, in which he explained, which is the book, it's a Kitab al-Hadith al-Ahkam, which the granddad of Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah wrote. He also took knowledge from the scholar which we all know, Al-Allama Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqita rahimahullah, the author of the book Adwa al-Bayan, and he stayed with him for 10 years, not 2 weeks and 3 weeks, but 10 years. He stayed with Shaykh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti, فَلَازَمَهُ 10 سَنَوَاتٍ 10 years he stayed with him. The things that he took from him and he took from him was tafsir of the Qur'an. He also took from him Adabul Bahth wal Munadara, which is one of the books Shaykh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti wrote. As Shaykh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti was, and anyone who read his biography, Atiyah Muhammad Salim wrote about his life. He also speaks about his life a little bit. He has a book called Rihlatu ila Ifriqiya. And there's a book called Rihlatu ila al-Hajj. Al-Sheikh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti. Sheikh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with knowledge. And those who know the Shanaqita, the scholars from Mauritania, they don't rely on papers and books. They rely on their memory and that which they know. And the Sheikh rahimahullah, every fen, he knew a alfi of it. Every field, he knew a thousand line of poetry regarding that field. Shaykh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti. And one of the things I read was Kitab Adbu al-Namir, which is Majalis al-Tafsir of his, Shaykh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti, that one day he listened to his own tafsir, and he didn't realize it was him. And so he was amazed with it. He heard his own tafsir, and he was amazed with it, especially Surah Al-An'am, when Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti is refuting Ibn Hazm in the issue of qiyas, analogy. Because Ibn Hazm believed that analogy does not exist because the first person who did analogy was Iblis. When he said, خَلَقْتَنِي مِن نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْهُ I'm better than him because you created me from fire and you created... So he did an analogy. Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti refuted him. And all of this is from the top of his memory. He would sit there and he would just read the tafsir like that. The great noble scholar, Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti. His kitab Adab al-Bahth wa al-Munadara and his kitab al-Mudhakira fi Usul al-Fiqh. All of his athar right now, all of his works, they have been published together by Dar al-Alim al-Kutub. So he stayed with him for a very long time. He also, Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti, also memorized Lisan al-Arab, which is a dictionary. Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti, he memorized Lisan al-Arab, which is a dictionary. And he used to use it as istishhad, as evidence. Whenever he needed to define a word, he would just get the dictionary out of his mind and he would quote it. He memorized Tafsir al-Imam al-Qurtubi, rahimahullah. Al-Imam al-Qurtubi, Abu Abdullah al-Qurtubi. There's two Qurtubis, Abu al-Abbas and Abu Abdullah. Abu al-Abbas is the author of the kitab al-Mufhim lima ashkala fi sahih Muslim. No, Abu Abdullah al-Qurtubi, the one who wrote the Tafsir. Shaykh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti had the book in his mind. And when you look at his Adwa'ul Bayan, and you look at the kitab Ahkam al-Qur'an by Imam al-Qurtubi, you see a lot of resemblance, paragraphs that are exactly the same. And this is from the top of his. لذلك the poet, he said, لَن تَكُنْ حَافِظًا وَاعِيًا وَجَمْعُكَ لِلْكُتْبِ لَا يَنْفَعُ تَحْذُرُ بِالْجَهْلِ فِي مَجْلِسٍ وَكُتْبُكَ فِي الْبَيْتِ مُسْتَوْدِعُ. You're truly not going to be a scholar if everything you rely on books. You see, that's why I'm never going to reach a scholar while I have 4 or 5 books open. The scholar is the one who has everything he needs in his mind. You see? That's the one who's going to become a true scholar. Ala kulli hal, he also read on him the Kitab Al-Qasd wal-Umam fi Ansab al-Arabi wal-Ajam. By who? Al-Imam ibn Abdul Barr al-Andalusi rahimahullah. He read that book on Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti, Bakr Abu Zayd. And Bakr Abu Zayd, he was affected highly, meaning he was touched by Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti a lot. He loved him so much. And inshallah ta'ala, as we're going to be teaching this kitab, Hilyat al-Talib al-Ilm, we're going to see a place or two that, in which he speaks about his teacher highly and respects him, rahimahullah. Al-Shaykh Bakr Abu Zayd, he took manasib. Manasib means brothers, positions. He took a lot of positions. He once was, for a period of time, he was a mudarris. He was a teacher in the Haram al-Nabawi. Haram al-Madani, like Medina. He was sitting there, he had a dars in which he used to teach al-fara'id, inheritance, and he would also teach al-hadith. Also, the Shaykh rahimahullah, he became a udu. He became a member of Al-Majlis Al-Qadha' Al-Ali as a judge. He was also the mudir of Majma' Al-Fiqh Al-Islami. He was a mudir, or the ra'is, sorry. Also, he was a udu for Rabidat Al-Alim Al-Islami. He was also a udu, a member of Hayat Kibar Al-Ulama, and he was also a udu for Al-Lajna Al-Da'ima Lil-Buhut Al-Ilmiyyat Wal-Ifta. So the Shaykh had a lot of positions, alayhi rahmatullah. He wrote a lot of books. Shaykh Muhammad Amin al-Shanqidi, he wrote a lot of books. From the books he wrote is, and a lot of his books are not books, they're little rasail, small little books like this. A lot of them are like this, the things that he wrote. Writing big volumes, he hasn't done much. Rahimahullah. Ibn al-Qayyim, he wrote a book called Ibn al-Qayyim, Hayatu wa Atharuh. Ibn al-Qayyim, his life, and a bit about Ibn al-Qayyim, a volume this big, he wrote about it. He also has a book called Fiqh al-Nawazil, where he talks about things that have happened, newly introduced issues that have happened in this ummah, like, you know, new technologies and whatnot, and fiqh about it. He talks about it. He has a book called Mu'jam, Al-Mu'jam Al-Manahi Al-Lafziyya, which basically talks about what words can a person say, what names can you give your children, and what words are you allowed to use and what can't you say. He talks about it, alayhi rahmatullah. He has a book called Aqidat Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, he speaks about it. There's a book called At-Tasiru fi Usul al-Takhrij. He talks about how you can do takhrij of a hadith, which is only the first volume is being published, the rest hasn't been published. He also wrote a book called La Jadida fi Salati, there's nothing new in the prayer. That's what he called it, which is a Risala Saghira, a small book in which he authored, alayhi rahmatullah. He also has a book called Risalatun fi Salatul Tasabih, a Risala regarding the prayer Salatul Tasabih that people ask. He has a book also written about Risalatul Sabha, you know, the Tasbih that the people used, the Tasbih. Huh? Do you guys know it? He talks about its ruling and what is it. He also has a book called Risalatu Hajr al-Mubtadi', Boycotting the Innovator. He has a book called Hirasatu al-Fadila, Safeguarding the women in the hijab, and when the colonization, they came to the Muslim countries, how they affected the women's hijab and etc. He has a Risala which he speaks about, Fi Haddi Thawbi. He talks about the thawb that the men wear, the level that it should be. And Shaykh Abu Bakr Abu Zayd here, he took the view that the thawb that I'm wearing right now, this is a thawb, right? He believed that that wasn't permissible to make it half your shin. He said it's not permissible. Nisf al-saq, he said no. The only thing that is allowed, nisf al-saq, it has to be the izar, the one that you do from the middle. As for if it's a thawb, he said it has to be above the ankles, but it can't be half the shin. Because of the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar, it says, izarul mu'min nisf al-saq, the izar. And so he points that issue. He also has a book called Bid'u al-Qurra' al-Qadimah wal-Mu'asira. He talks about the innovations that the reciters they've come with. You know, these new different recitations where the reciter, he reads and it's like sometimes he goes for coffee and comes back. This is how long it is. It's quiet. He recites the ayah and he's so quiet. Or recitation which they call maqamat. Have you guys heard of it? He talks about it there. He also talks about a common thing in the Asian community and is present in the Somalian community, which is to move sort of like this all day. Huh? When reciting the Quran, the Shaykh talks about the ruling of that and when learning the Quran. So it's a very beneficial book. And I'm only telling you these so when you know the book, you can go to it and what topic it deals with. And other books that he has, rahimahullah. Other books in which he has. Good. Now we're going to bi-idhnillah al-kareem start the book. The Shaykh started his book by saying, Alhamdulillah, he praises to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Shaykh said, Alhamdu لِلَّهِ. So the publications are slightly different. Some might add something to it, some might deduct something from it, but we will stick to the one that Dar ibn al-Jawzi published. You see, for him and Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen alayhi rahmatullah, the explanation that he put on the book, we're going to be relying on that as well. So that matin and the Dar ibn al-Jawzi, both of them is what we're going to rely on. One thing I want you to all, inshallah ta'ala, keep an eye for is Bakr Abu Zayd's translations that I looked at, the English translations, they have some mistakes in it, the translation. Huh? And I believe the reason because is the caliber that the Shaykh speaks Arabic at is fa'iq, is very high. When he speaks the language, he speaks in the language in a very tough way. ولذلك Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen, when he was explaining his book, Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen said that nobody can understand Bakr unless he has a dictionary with him. No one can read Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd's book unless he has with him what? And that is the reality. So inshallah ta'ala, some words, my English isn't to that caliber as well, but some words, I'll explain it. Instead of translate it to English, I'll explain what it means. But then you can go back to the English translations, all of the ones I've looked at, they have their mistakes in it. Okay? So the Sheikh starts the book by saying Alhamdu, praise is Lillahi, praises for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everyone knows what Alhamdu means. Alhamdu means it is Wasfullahi tabaraka wa ta'ala bi sifatil kamal. It is to describe Allah with noble characteristics. That is what Alhamdu means. It is to speak about Allah with high characteristics. Alhamdu, praise. Now this alif and lam in alhamdu, grammatically the scholars, they differed on it. Some said that the alif and lam is al-jins. And some said no, it is al-istighraq. There's two views regarding the alhamdu, the alif and lam in it. And based on those two different opinions, what comes out of it is different, of course. What is it? If we say alhamdu, it means al-istighraq, then it means all praise is to Allah. Are you with me? Al-istighraq means any alif al-lam where in its place you can put the word kul, meaning kullul hamd lillah. All praises to who? Allah. So then istighraq means what, brothers? It means every praise is for Allah. So that's the first view. The second view is that the alif al-lam here, it's not istighraq, it means jinsul hamd, meaning hamd itself is for Allah. Hamd itself is for Allah. And why would those group not choose istighraq, and why would they refuse? They said because if we say all praises to Allah, then that means we can't praise anybody other than Allah. Yeah? We can't praise other than Allah. Ibn al-Qayyim has a 6-volume book called Bada'i al-Fawa'id. He deals with this issue in very extensive. So just show you, go there and look at it yourself, inshallah ta'ala. Alhamdu. Lillahi, the lam in lillahi, the lam in lillahi. Alhamdu. Lillahi. That lam is called lamul ikhtisas. Specifically for him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, no one else. Alhamdu. All praise, Amma. Alhamd itself is for Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala. Wa ba'du. The word wa ba'du, it's not good to say wa ba'du. It is better to say amma ba'du. Even that though they say that the word the waw is a badal, meaning it takes the place of the amma ba'du. But we want to stick to the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and say amma ba'du. The word amma ba'du, what does it mean? Amma ba'du in the Arabic language, it means intiqal min usloob ila usloobin akhar. It means to move from one form of speech and that which you were saying, and you're going to move on to something else. Basically trying to say, after praising Allah, I want to say. So you're moving from the praising onto something else. You with me? And the scholars, they differed upon who was the first person to use the word amma ba'du. The strongest view, or the majority of the scholars, are of the view that the word amma ba'du, the first person to ever use it, was Dawood alayhi salam. And they said, because Allah said in the Quran, وَآتَيْنَاهُ فَصْلَ الْخِطَابِ. We gave him what? Dawood was given what? فصل الخطاب. فصل الخطاب, they said it means أما بعد. That he would be able to distinguish between two different types of speeches. So أما بعد. So the Sheikh here said وَبَعْدُ, to proceed. فَأُقَيِّدُ فَأُقَيِّدُ, I will write.